250 in your hymnal, 250. There's within my heart a melody Jesus whispers sweet and low. Let's all stand together as we sing. He keeps me singing on that verse together. There's within my heart a melody Jesus whispers sweet and low. Fear not, I am with thee. Peace be still in all of life's ebb and flow. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know. Fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go. On that third, feasting on the riches of his grace, the resting neath a sheltering wing, always looking on his smiling face. That is why I shout and sing. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know. Fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go. On that last, soon he's coming back to welcome me. Far beyond the starry sky, I shall wing my flight to worlds unknown. I shall reign with him on high. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know. Fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go.
All right, good singing, and good to see you here today. Beautiful fall morning. And glad you made it to church for church service today. Looking forward to what the Lord has in store for us this morning. Let's open with a word of prayer together, shall we? Father, we bow before you in prayer. We thank you for another beautiful morning that you have blessed us with. Thank you, Lord, for the health and strength that we have to be here today. We do pray for those who are unable to be here this morning because of health reasons, and that you would put your healing hand upon them. Others are in the hospital. I pray for Paula Ross this morning, that you'll heal her, Lord, and raise her up to be back with us very soon. Lord, others that have loved ones and relatives, friends who are suffering this morning, I pray that you would show yourself strong on their behalf today. Now, Lord, we bow before you here at the beginning of our service and ask you to meet with us. Lord, we want you to minister to each of our hearts today. We don't just want to go through the ritual of saying we went to church on Sunday. We'd like to leave in a little bit saying, God spoke to my heart today, and God met with me this morning. And so, Lord, use the music and the fellowship together, the songs that we sing to you, and the preaching of your word to accomplish your will in our lives and in our hearts this morning. May you be pleased with the service. Use it for your glory and your honor. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, you may be seated.
Burden you bear.
Go to number 50 in your hymnal, 50. Would you be free from your burden of sin? There's power, wonder-working power in the blood. On that first together, would you be free from the burden of sin? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you or evil a victory win? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you be free from your passion and pride? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Come for a cleansing to Calvary's side. There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. On that last, would you do service for Jesus your King? You live daily his praises to sing. There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb.
All right, a few announcements for us now. Listen carefully, if you will. Regular schedule tonight, 5:30, we have a Christian growth class. That's open for anyone who would like to attend. And tonight's lesson at 5:30 in the conference room is going to be getting along with others. Okay, probably nobody needs it, but just in case you might know somebody who does, you can come get that class tonight, how to get along with other people. All right. Then 6:30 tonight will be the evening service right back here in the auditorium. And Lord willing, tonight I'm going to talk to you on the subject, I think myself happy. All right. I think myself happy. Quote from the Apostle Paul. And I think that'll be a blessing to you this evening. Ladies, don't forget your night out is tomorrow night. There's a sign up sheet for that down on the table in the foyer. And I think it's Lessons from a Leaf. Is that right? Sound right? Leaf. And you're going to enjoy that study tomorrow night. You get to do a craft. You get food to eat. I was informed you don't have to have dinner. You'll have plenty to fill up on here. So you just come and enjoy that 6:30 tomorrow night. I think it's $5. And you sign up for that downstairs if you would. And then in the bulletin, there's some information about registering to vote. If you're not yet registered to vote, Tuesday is the deadline. There are registration forms down on the table. Follow the instructions there in the bulletin or on the form there and get that in. I believe it's your right as a citizen. I think it's your duty as a citizen to vote. And we have an opportunity to have a say in our government. And we ought not to pass up that opportunity. Amen? And so take advantage of that if you're not registered. I hope you'll take care of that. All right. Then remember, next Sunday will be Old Fashioned Sunday. Okay. So wear your old fashioned clothes and don't say, "Oh, I dress old fashioned every Sunday." No, don't do that kind of thing. Get old fashioned. Now, you know, we're not going back to the Garden of Eden old fashioned. Okay. We want to go a little more modern than that. Okay. But wear the old-fashioned ladies do wear their dresses and the fellas, and it's a fun day. It really is. Dinner on the grounds after the service. Sign up for that downstairs and stay for dinner next week. And It's always a great, great time. And then next Sunday night, we'll have kerosene lamps, and we'll have everything will be decorated here old-fashioned wise, and we have the Hallelujah offering on Sunday night. And if you've never been part of the Hallelujah offering, you got to be part of that on next Sunday evening, okay? It's a great day, and we'll look forward to old-fashioned Sunday next Sunday, all right? Well, let's take a moment, and we'll welcome any guests we have with us today. And anybody have somebody visiting? Anybody visiting here today for the very first time? You've got a visitor right down here. Lydia, who do you have with you? Marquise. Good to have you this morning. Thank you. Boy, both of you chew on the end of your coat. And that's interesting. Is that how you met? Is there a chew on the end of your rope club or something? Okay, it's good to have you today. Marquise, appreciate you being here. All right. And Brenda, introduce your guest for us, would you? Good. Good to see you, Mindy. Thank you for being here this morning. That's great. On vacation and came to church. How about that? That's impressive. Thank you. Good to have you this morning. All right. Anyone else today? I don't think anybody for the first time. All right. If you'll be kind enough to fill the card out, we appreciate you doing that. In a little bit, we have an offering. Just put that card in the plate. And when it goes by, keep the pen as our gift to you for coming. We're glad you're here this morning. Let's give them a warm welcome, shall we?
I am so glad that our Father in heaven tells of his love in the book he has given. Jesus loves even me. 277, let's sing that first together. I am so glad that our Father in heaven tells of the love in the book he has given. Wonderful things in the Bible I see. This is the dearest that Jesus loves me. I am so glad that Jesus loves me. Jesus loves me. I am so glad that Jesus loves me. Jesus loves even. forget him and wander away. Still he does love me wherever I stray. Back to his dear loving arms would I flee. When I remember that Jesus loves me, I am so glad that Jesus loves me. Jesus loves me, Jesus loves me. I am so glad that Jesus loves me. Jesus loves even me. As we sing the last verse together, children, you're dismissed to junior church. Children, you can go on to junior church. Let's sing that last together. Oh, if there's only one song I can sing, when in his beauty I see the great King. Oh, if there's only one song I can sing, when in his beauty I see the great King. This shall my song in eternity be. Oh, what a wonder that Jesus loves me. I am so glad that Jesus loves me. Jesus loves me, Jesus loves me. I am so glad that Jesus loves me. Jesus loves even me. Amen, that's great. Let's go over to 294 together, 294. My faith has found a resting place, not in device nor creed. Would you stand with me as we sing? 294 together. My faith has found a resting place, not in device nor creed. I trust the ever-living one, his wounds for me shall plead. I need no other argument, I need no other plea. It is enough that Jesus died, and that he died for me. Let's sing that third. My heart is leaning on the word, the written word of God. Salvation by my Savior's name, salvation through his blood. I need no other argument, I need no other plea. That Jesus died, and that he died for me. Amen. Greet one another. Make somebody feel welcome, especially our guest. We'll come back and sing that last stanza together. Enough for me that Jesus saves, this ends my fear and doubt. A sinful soul, I come to him, He'll never cast me out. I need no other argument. I need no other plea. It is enough that Jesus died and that he died for me. My great physician, he heals the sick, the lost he came to save. Let's sing that last together. My great physician heals the sick, the lost he came to save. For me his precious blood he shed, he gave. I need no other argument, I need no other plea. It is enough that Jesus died and that he died for me. Let's sing that chorus one more time without the instruments. Let's sing that up. I need no other argument. I need no other plea. It is enough that Jesus died and that he died for me.
Great singing. You can be seated. Ushers will come and be ready to receive our offering this morning. Give as God has blessed and prospered you today. We'll ask God's blessing on our offering. Brother Bill McKeon, lead us in our prayer, would you please?
Okay, let's pray. Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for the opportunities we have to learn more about you and to serve you, Lord. And bless the gift and the giver. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you, Lisa. I apologize for those who were talking through your offertory. Let's take our Bibles this morning and go to James chapter 4, if you would please. James chapter 4 for our scripture reading. James chapter 4, and we're going to read verses 13 through 17 of James chapter 4. James 4, verses 13 through 17. We'll read the verses responsively. We begin together on 13, then I'll read 14. We'll alternate till we end together on verse 17 of James chapter 4. And as our custom is, let's stand together to read the scripture. All of us standing, please, to read God's word. And let's begin together on verse 13 of James chapter 4. Ready? Go to now, ye that say, today or tomorrow we will go into such a city and continue there a year, and buy and sell and get gain, whereas ye know not what shall be on the morrow. For what is your life? It is even a vapor that appeareth for a little time and then vanisheth away. For that ye ought to say, If the Lord will, we shall live and do this or that. But now you rejoice in your boastings. All such rejoicing is evil. Therefore, to him that knoweth to do good and doeth it not, to him it is sin. And let's pray together, shall we? Father, add your blessing, please, to the reading of our scripture here this morning. We thank you, Lord, for the wonderful music today. Thank you for the good spirit that's in this place. Thank you for each individual, every family that's gathered together here today. And Lord, we pray that you will make our hearts ready to receive your word this morning. Lord, help us to be focused and tune our hearts to your heart, that we'll all have ears to hear what the Spirit would say to each of us this morning. And I pray you'd bless the special now to that end. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. Now, Father, we bow before you in prayer, and we thank you, Lord, for your goodness to us. We thank you for the Bible this morning. And, Lord, I'm bowing before you and asking for your help as I bring the message here today and asking for your help for the people as they listen this morning. And I pray that your will would be done in our lives today and that this service and this message would not just be what I desire to be or what the people would desire to be, but it would be exactly what you desire it to be. As the, if you just was sung, Lord, that you would touch our hearts with your word today. May we realize that Jesus of Nazareth passes this way this morning. And I pray that you would touch our hearts today as only you can. And I'll thank you for it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I'm going to ask you a couple questions or a few questions here this morning, and I just want you to participate with me, all right? You raise your hand if you can say yes to any of these, all right? How many of you ever purchased a home in your lifetime? Let me see your hand. Okay, all right. Put them down. How many of you ever worked a job in your life? Let me see your hand. That's a few more. Okay, thank you. And how many ever took a vacation in your life? Okay, good. How many would like to take a vacation in your life? Yeah, there you go. Everybody's hand goes up. Anybody ever bought a car? Okay, good. Anybody ever, how about that? Everybody bought a bicycle? Yeah, okay, there we go. How about get the young people? Anybody bought a video game? Yeah, okay, good. All right. How many folks are married? Okay, good. All right. How many have had children? Okay, good. How many have been to college? Okay. How many are planning to go to college? Good, good. All right. Good to see the young people raise their hand. Amen. Just a little survey there. No scientific thing or anything. But I think I hit just about everybody with those questions. But what I want you to think about in light of the scripture we're going to look at this morning, and I don't want you to raise your hands on this, but whenever it was that you bought the house or bought the car or took a vacation or purchased an appliance or bought a bicycle, whatever, or took a job, did you pray before you made that decision? Did you ask God whether it's what He wanted you to do? The scary thing is that when it comes to marrying somebody or entering into some big decision, we tend to pray about those things. But when we just need a new car, we just go shop for another car. Or an appliance breaks down, we just go start looking for an appliance that we have to replace, that refrigerator or the dishwasher or whatever it is that is broken down. And we don't always seek God's guidance in the purchases of life or many of our decisions that we make in life. Now, I'm not saying that you can't make plans. I think the Bible's for making plans. I think as you read through the scripture, you'll see that Paul oftentimes talked about what he planned to do or what he wanted to do, because I do believe if you don't plan on going anywhere, then you're never going to get there. If you aim at nothing, you're going to hit it every time. And I think the Bible's clear on that. But the question is, that James asks, is God involved in your plans? What Paul wrote at times was, I'd like to go here, but he talked about going into Bithynia, but the Spirit wouldn't let me. Or he talked about going here if the Lord permits. He would use phrases to let you understand that whatever I'm planning is contingent on God's plan for me. It has to be whether the Lord is willing or not. We have decisions to make. We have to seek God's will and learn to understand what God has in mind for us. James is talking about in these five verses, if your Bible's open in James, he says there's people here that say, today or tomorrow we're going to go into such a city, continue there a year, buy, sell, and get gain. What they're saying on, here's what we're going to do. We're going to go into this city and we're going to buy and sell and trade and we're going to get gain. You know what that means? We're going to make some money. And then when we're done there, we're going to go to this city and we're going to buy and sell and get gain and we're going to make some money there. Now, the point here is not about making money. The point here is about making plans with no thought of God in your plans at all. That's the point that he's coming across with. Instead of prayerfully making their plans, they're completely oblivious to the fact God may change their plans, move them in a different direction. Now, generally speaking, most of us don't necessarily, we don't always like to get God involved in our plans. I read a quote this week from somebody who said, people will do what they want to do. Could I get this on, please? Fan, thank you. People will do what they want to do. And then they boast about what they're doing or what they're going to do. And we oftentimes don't want God involved in it because Listen, when you put God involved, that means you lose control and God's in control. And most people want to live their lives in control. That's the issue that James is going to deal with here. In fact, hold your finger there in James chapter 4 and look over in the Gospel of Luke with me, would you please? Luke chapter 12. Jesus gives an example of a fella like this. Luke chapter 12. Jesus said, he spake a parable unto them, saying, verse 16, the ground of a certain rich man brought forth plentifully. And he thought within himself, you know, thinking to yourself and praying to God are two different things. Okay? So he thought within himself, and he said, what shall I do, because I have no room where to bestow my fruits? And he said, this will I do. I will pull down my barns and build greater, and there will I bestow my fruits and my goods. And I will say to my soul, soul, thou hast much goods laid up for many years. Take thine ease, eat, drink, and be merry. Here's a man, been successful, has had, in the eyes of anybody in the world, would look at this fellow and say, man, look at that guy. Look at all that he's got. In fact, he can't even fit it all in the storage barns that he has. He's going to have to tear those down and build bigger barns. And then he'll fill those up. He says, I've got it laid up. I've got my future mapped out. I've got the retirement of all retirements planned. And what did God say to him? Verse number 20. God said to him, thou fool, this night thy soul shall be required of thee. Then who shall those things be which thou hast provided? By the way, nothing wrong with making plans, but what he did, he made plans without considering God. No godness plans at all. I'll do this, I'll do that, just like the people said in James. I was thinking along these lines, you know, you ever think about people who have made plans but never got to realize those plans? You remember, how many of you are old enough to remember 1986 and the Challenger and the school teacher, Krista McAuliffe? Remember that name? Never got to realize her plans, did she? You see, I thought about the people on the Titanic coming to America to fulfill their dreams and their plans. Never got to see it happen. Never took into account what God might have in mind. God has a plan. I'm talking this morning on what are your plans. And the truth is, whatever the plans are, you better ask God what His plan is. I understand that when you read letters that Christians wrote about 100 years ago, I'm just taking Don Taylor's word for this, that they would write a postscript on their letters. He's listening. Good. They'd write a postscript, D-V, D-V. The letters stood for the Latin words, Deo volente, which means God willing. God willing. And that's what James says. He's saying it's not wrong to make plans. He told the people in chapter 4, he said, you ought to say, it's not that you shouldn't say at all, but you ought to say, if the Lord will, we'll do this or that. Not wrong to say, I'm going to go to this city, or I'm going to try to buy and sell and get gain, but you better add to it, God willing. If God be willing, I'll do this. In fact, we sometimes make statements like that, don't we? You say, hey, we'll see you tomorrow. Well, Lord willing, and the creek don't rise. Takes on new meaning in the South these days, doesn't it? You understand, it's not a new thing. It's not a new problem. When Jesus told his disciples how he was going to suffer and die on the cross and be betrayed in the hands of sinners and die, Peter took him and began to what? Rebuke him. That isn't it. That can't be right. You know why? That wasn't Peter's plan. That wasn't what he figured the way it ought to be. You had to understand that God had a plan. And it wasn't Peter's plan. Joseph had a plan. In fact, he had a dream, and he was sure that everybody's going to end up bowing down to him. I'll guarantee you, if you said, "Well, Peter, Joseph, how's that plan going to work out?" He wouldn't have included being sold as a slave and being a slave in Egypt and having a prison record, and he wouldn't have went that route. But did God have a plan? God had a plan. But I think the best example of this and where we're going to look at this morning is back in the book of Judges. And I'd like you to look there if you would please. Judges chapter 7. Judges 7, we come on this man named Gideon. And in Gideon, as they're fighting a group of people called the Midianites, we're going to learn an important lesson. And when we talk about God's plan and our plan, you're gonna learn something, and the can I help you? The sooner you learn it, the better off you'll be. And that is this lesson, that God's plan may not always be the easiest plan, and it's certainly not the most popular plan, and sometimes it's not the most sensical plan, if sensical's a word. But I'll guarantee you this morning, it is always the best plan. God's plan is always the best plan. Let's glean some lessons here from Gideon and God's plan here with defeating the Midianites. The first thing I'd like to point out to you, beginning in verse number 2, is that God's plan is a different plan than my plan. God's plan is a different plan than my plan. Notice what happened. The Lord said to Gideon, "The people that are with thee are too many for me to give the Midianites into their hands, lest Israel vaunt themselves against me, saying, Mine own hand hath saved me. Now therefore go to, proclaim in the ears of the people, saying, Whosoever is fearful and afraid, let him return and depart early from Mount Gilead. And there returned to the people 22,000, and there remained 10,000. And the Lord said to Gideon, The people are yet too many. Bring them down to the water, and I will try them for thee there. And it shall be that of whom I say unto thee, This shall go with thee, the same shall go with thee. And of whomsoever I say unto thee, This shall not go with thee, the same shall not go. So he brought down the people under the water. The Lord said unto Gideon, Everyone that lappeth of the water with his tongue, as a dog lappeth, him shalt thou set by himself. Likewise, everyone that boweth down upon his knees to drink. And the number of them that lapped, putting their hand to their mouth, were 300. But all the rest of the people bowed down on their knees to drink the water. And the Lord said unto Gideon, By the 300 men that lapped will I save you, and deliver the Midianites into thine hand, and let all the other people go, every man unto his place. So Gideon starts with 32,000. And I'm sure, listen, that's not great. It's not tremendous compared to the Midianites. They would probably be outnumbered about 4 or 5 to 1. But you know what? We're good, and we got good soldiers, and maybe we'll take those odds, all right? But then God comes to him, and he says, you have too many for me. And I'm sure Gideon said, I like this number. It's fine with me. And God says, it's not okay with me. Israel will want to take the credit. And so God begins to work that plan, and he gets it down to just 300. And I'm sure Gideon had to sit there that night and think, this isn't how I figured it would be. You ever step back and look at your life and say, this isn't quite how I figured it would go? Huh? You've been there? And you realize that not you just didn't have a plan, God had a plan. David, I think, had a plan to just be a faithful shepherd. He was just out tending sheep. Even when Samuel came to anoint the next king, God sent him to Jesse's house. And all the other brothers came, and none of them were the one the Lord wanted. And Samuel had to ask him, "You got anybody else?" Oh, yeah, I got one more out taking care of the sheep. And I really believe that's all David wanted to do. In fact, after he was anointed, he went back to the sheep. Back to tending sheep. But God certainly had a plan for his life. Did you ever think about Joseph and Mary? Ever think about their plans for their life? You understand, nowadays, for a couple to have a child out of wedlock is not a shocking thing to us anymore. By the way, it's still wrong. God's order is marriage and then intimate relations and having children. Make sure you keep it in the right order. Amen, Pastor. Thank you. You're welcome. Okay? That is the right order to take it. Now, if someone, listen, and I'm sure they had those dreams. Hey, I think she had a dream of a wonderful wedding. She had a dream of people coming to see her get married and then having a family and all that goes along with it. And you found out that God had some other plans, didn't he? Angel came to Mary and said, you're going to bear the Christ child. Wow. And then he had to appear to Joseph to convince him, don't put her away. Don't kill her. And they had to endure the ridicule and everyone else. When you try to tell everybody, no, Joseph and I have been pure. We've kept ourselves for each other, but I'm expecting. And it's of God. Sure it is. They had to take the ridicule. They had to take all the doubters. They had to go through that. I understand. They had to sometime at night in their quiet moments say, I never planned it to be like this. Never thought it would be like this. Brother Moreland, just thought he'd be a fireman, paramedic. He had a plan. It was going well. But God had a different plan. And he found out that, well, I had a plan, but God's plan is different than my plan. Amen? God had another plan. Who could lift their hand this morning and say, you know, I'm 30 years old or 40 years old or 50 years old or 60 years old, and my life has gone exactly the way I planned it to go? Anybody? Yeah. Can I tell you? It has gone exactly the way God planned it to go. None of it surprised God. His plan is different than my plan. Gideon learned that lesson. But secondly, I want you to notice God declared his plan. God declared his plan. Look at verse number 9. It came to pass the same night that the Lord said unto him, arise, get thee down to the host. I have delivered into thine hand. If thou fear to go down, go thou with Phurah, thy servant, down to the host. Thou shalt hear what they say. Afterwards shall thine hand be strengthened to go down unto the host. Then went he down with Phurah, his servant, under the outside of the armed men that were in the host. And the Midianites and the Amalekites and all the children of the east lay along the valley like grasshoppers for multitude, and their camels were without number as the sand by the seaside for multitude. Gideon was come. Behold, there was a man that told a dream unto his fellow and said, behold, I dreamed a dream, and lo, a cake of barley bread tumbled into the host of Midian and came unto a tent and smote it that it fell and overturned it that the tent lay along. And his fellow answered and said, this is nothing else save the sword of Gideon, the son of Joash, a man of Israel. For into his hands hath God delivered Midian and all the host. So God lets Gideon know his plan. He says, you go down to the host of Gideon, and he goes down there close to the camp, and he hears two Midianite fellas talking. And the one fellow says, I had a dream, and he talks about this loaf of barley bread tumbling down into the camp, and it wipes out the camp. And he says, well, I know what that is. That's Gideon. I don't know how well Gideon felt. I'm just a loaf of bread, but that's what he was. And we're going to be defeated by him. So now God lets it be known to Gideon. But I want you also know it's going to require faith to take that step. And to once God declares His plan for you, it always is going to require faith on your part to take it. You won't see the way. Well, I don't see how I can quit being a paramedic. I don't see how I can quit my job. I don't see how I can quit doing this and do what God wants. You're going to have all kinds of things you won't see because God's asking you to step out by faith. God's asked you to follow His plan by faith. Obeying God's plan will always require faith on our part. Now, let me tell you, God will always declare His plan in the commands and the principles of the Bible. God always declares His plan in the commands and the principles of the Bible. We'll say more about that in just a little bit. So often, listen, so often we resort to other things. People get crazy when they're trying to discern what God's plan is for their life or what God's will is when they come to making decisions. I told you I was at a conference and this one fellow was relating how he went to a counselor, a pastor, and he and this girl, and he's interested in this girl. He says, how do I know if she's the one I'm supposed to marry? You won't believe this. Pastor said, here. He pulled the chair up and said, had that girl sit here. And he had the girl sit there. He said, I want you to walk around her 7 times. And if the walls of her heart fall, then she's the one. That's not biblical counsel. You pardon me, but that's stupidity. That's not biblical counseling. We do, talking manual's language there, huh? We use all sorts of things to try to figure out God's will. God's will and God's plan is found in the principles and commands of the Bible. We want to go with reasoning. We want to go with experiences. Well, let me tell you what I did when that happened to me. Or let me tell you what I had a cousin-in-law's brother's sister who this happened to, and here's what they did. And we go all off the map trying to decide on what God wants us to do instead of looking to God's Word. That's the very first and foremost place we go to. We decide on the principles and commands of God's Word. God has declared His plan. Don't just because we're ignorant of what He said doesn't mean it's not there. Now, He's not going to say, buy the house and live on, Clark Street. He's not going to say that, wear this outfit on Sunday morning. But you know what? There are principles in the Bible that guide those decisions. And you have to understand those principles and know those principles. So God declares His plan. Then God has a distinct plan. He tells Gideon, verse 15, Gideon heard the telling of the dream, the interpretation thereof. He worshipped, returned to the host of Israel, and said, arise, for the Lord hath delivered into your hand the host of Midian. He divided the 300 men into 3 companies, put a trumpet in every man's hand with empty pitchers and lamps within the pitchers. And he said unto them, look on me and do likewise. And behold, when I come to the outside of the camp, it shall be that as I do, so shall ye do. When I blow with a trumpet, I and all that are with me, then blow ye the trumpets also on every side of all the camp, and say, the sword of the Lord and of Gideon. So Gideon and the 100 men that were with him came unto the outside of the camp in the beginning of the middle watch, and they had but newly set the watch. They blew the trumpets, brake the pitchers that were in their hands, and the 3 companies blew the trumpets, brake the pitchers, and held the lamps in their left hands and the trumpets in their right hands to blow withal. And they cried, the sword of the Lord and of Gideon. And they stood, every man in his place, round about the camp. And all the host ran and cried and fled. And the 300 blew the trumpets, and the Lord set every man's sword against his fellow, even throughout all the host. And the host fled to Bethshitta in Zereth, and to the border of Abel-Meholah unto Tabith. And God gave them great victory that day for the children of Israel. 300 versus thousands, tens of thousands. He says, here's my distinct plan, Gideon. You're going to take those 100 men and surround them. And here's what you're going to have for weaponry. You're going to have a trumpet. You're going to have a pitcher. And I'm going to put a candle in that pitcher. There you go. Wait a minute, Lord. We got to have some rocket launchers. We got to have something here to work with us. Got to have something going on. No. It says, oh yeah, I forgot. When you break the pitcher, you're going to blow the trumpet, then you're all going to yell, the sword of the Lord and of Gideon. Oh yeah, that's going to scare them. Think about that. Think about that, how distinctive God's plan was. I mean, honestly now, if you were one of those 300 men and Gideon's explaining this to you, would you have thought, yeah, man, that's going to lead to victory? You'd have thought, what is he talking about? That's all we got? See, it God's plan, listen, God's plan is always distinct from all other plans. It's different than your plan. It's going to require faith. He declares it. You have to follow it and believe it and know that it's distinct. But it will always, number four, it always requires surrender. You have to surrender to his plan. I think Gideon felt pretty good when he said, I'm going to be a general over 32,000 men. That's pretty impressive. It's not quite the same when you say, I'm a general over 300 men. Not quite the same. And then, of course, God compared him, as you know. Just in case Gideon was thinking that he was somebody, the Lord let him hear that dream that a barley loaf is tumbling down into the camp. And that barley loaf is you. Barley loaves were not hard to come by. You know, listen, you can always be too big for God to use. You can never be too small for God to use. God resists the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Surrendered. Gideon's going to learn it's not about the Israelites. It's not about the Midianites. And it's not about Gideon. It is about God. And he's going to teach him that. It's about God's will. Are you willing to lay aside your dreams, your plans, your desires, your ambitions for God's plan? For what God wants? That's what Romans 12 talks about when you're a living sacrifice, wholly acceptable unto God, surrendering to the will of God. I'm talking to people in the room today, I'll guarantee it. Frustrated. Some cases you've just come to accept it, but you know the reason that there's struggles in your life, there's underlying anger in your life, there's underlying frustration in your life, is because you know that at some point you knew what God wanted you to do and you did not surrender. You did your will, not his will. It takes surrender. God's plan is different than my plan. God's declared his plan to me. He has a distinct plan. His plan requires surrender. Number five, his plan requires us to be steadfast. Now listen, why is that important? Because it's not going to be easy. How easy do you think it was for these 100 men to circle about that camp, Midianites? They have all kinds of weapons. They have spears, they have arrows, they have all the things of war. And here they stand in their place, 100 at a time, with a pitcher, with a candle in it, and a trumpet. Bring it on. I tell you what, that's not easy. It would have been easy to say, man, I don't see how this is going to happen. You know what's amazing? They did exactly as they were told to do. They did exactly what God said to do. Even though, if you'd have looked at it, if you would look at that, you'd have laughed. You said, you got to be kidding me. This can't be real. This can't work. But they followed the plan. 1 Corinthians 15:58, be therefore steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. And he has to remind them, for as much as ye know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord, it's not empty. And he has to tell that to people who think that, man, I'm serving God and I'm not seeing anything happen. I'm not seeing what I was expecting to see. He's saying, oh no, stay steadfast, unmovable. Keep on doing what God, you know, God told you to do. The victory is going to come. And by the way, why? Because number six, following God's plan defeats the enemy. Following God's plan defeats the enemy. When they blew the trumpets and did what Gideon told them to do, the host ran, cried, fled. They turned on each other. They ran away. When you follow God's plan, when you do what God wants you to do, and you follow His will for your life, listen to me, you defeat the enemy. He runs the other way. The path to victory is God's plan. The path to victory is following God's will for your life. And listen, God's will isn't just for the pastor or just for the missionary or just for the evangelist or just for those who are what we call, full time. No. God's will is for every single Christian to follow, for every single Christian to live. God's will is your path to fulfillment. God's will is your path to satisfaction. God's will is your path to satisfaction in life and doing, fulfilling the purpose for which God put you here. Am I doing what God placed me on this earth to do? That's for everybody. When you walk in God's plan for your life, you never walk in defeat. You always walk in victory. I'm competitive. I grew up with sports and in a sports family, and it doesn't matter what the game is, we're keeping score. And somebody's going to win and somebody's going to lose. And with by God's grace, I'm going to win. Okay? And if I lose, I'm going to congratulate you, but I'm going to under my breath say, but I'm going to get you next time. Okay? I don't like this whole thing of let's just play. Let's not keep score. What's that about? You know? I like victory, amen? I've been on victory and I've been on defeat and I like victory. I've won and I've lost and I like winning. Most people do. Well, listen, why settle for losing in the Christian life? Why settle for losing in your Christian walk? Why settle for losing in your battle against evil or your battle against the flesh? You don't have to settle for defeat. The key is don't go in the way that seems right to you. Go in the way that God says is right. There's a way that seems right unto a man, but the end thereof are the ways of death. God's plan is a different plan than my plan. He's declared His plan. It's a distinct plan. It requires surrender. It requires me to steadfast. It will defeat the enemy. And let me say this in closing. When you follow God's plan, His name is honored. When you follow God's plan, His name is honored. You remember why God said, I can't let you have 32,000? Why did God tell Gideon, I can't let you fight with 32,000? Because they'll brag about how they won the victory. They'll bring honor to themselves. Oh, how many times I listen to Christians talk about I did this and I said this and I went this and I. Listen. The victory was won without any of them having any weapons. Nobody fired a shot, so to speak. God gave them that victory. And it was won without a great army, one without great weaponry. All the glory had to go to God. In 1 Corinthians 1, Paul talks to the church at Corinth. And by the way, he had to put this in. In fact, let's look there. We got time. Your dinner will hold. Hold on. Look at 1 Corinthians chapter 1. We're almost done. The landing gear is down. Your tray tables are in the upright position and will soon be landing. But I want you to see 1 Corinthians chapter 1, okay? Now, you understand the church he's writing to. Not a spiritual church, a carnal church. A church where there was a lot of pride. They took even pride in their preachers. I'm Apollos, I'm of Peter, and I'm of Paul, and it was not a model church at all. And so Paul has to deal with some of this, and he says, in fact, he says in verse number 25 of chapter 1, notice Paul says, because the foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weakness of God is stronger than men. Now you see your brother, your calling, brethren, how that not many wise men after the flesh, not many mighty, not many noble are called. But God hath chosen the foolish things of the world to confound the wise. God hath chosen the weak things of the world to confound the things which are mighty. And base things of the world, and the things which are despised, hath God chosen. Yea, things which are not, to bring to naught things that are. God says, notice who he chooses. Weak. Base. Despised. Things which are not. People don't even regard them at all. God says, that's who I choose to serve me. So, well, I resent that. I'm somebody. Then you're not somebody God will use. That whole idea, I'm somebody. You know what that is? That's psychology. That's not Bible. I know that'll get a crowd. I know you can tell everybody, get everybody worked up that way. But God says, I choose these things. Why? Why would God choose a bunch of ragtag people like us to do his work? You know why? Verse 29. That no flesh should glory in his presence. I know sometimes we look at people and say, boy, if that guy gets saved or if that girl gets saved, boy, they're so sharp, they're so intelligent, they're so, can speak well, they're eloquent. Man, they'll do great things for God. Maybe so, maybe not. More than likely, God will take somebody who nobody thinks anything of. And the world would certainly not think anything of. Because all the glory goes to God. Doesn't go to us. No flesh should glory in his presence. They couldn't. None of those 300 men could brag about what they did. How do you brag about blowing a trumpet and breaking a pitcher? And everybody runs away? God did that. You have to give glory to God. He's the only one that deserves to. When you turn away from your plan and you embrace God's plan, then you can be assured of victory and God will get the glory. God will receive the glory. And that's what life's about, isn't it? Is life about pointing people to you and all you do? Or is life about pointing people to God and what he can do? William Carey was a great missionary. In fact, he opened up the continent of India, to he opened that up to the gospel. They call William Carey the father of modern missions. Did a tremendous work. And when William Carey was finally coming back to America as an old man, many churches were building up his return and scheduling him in to preach and were saying great words about him, and it made him very, very uncomfortable. He did not like that they were focusing on William Carey. And he made this statement when he got up in every church he went to. He said, "You've been speaking about William Carey, but when I am gone, say nothing about William Carey. Speak only of William Carey's Savior. Speak only of William Carey's Savior." Now let me ask you a question this morning. Started out with questions. I'll finish with a question. Your plan or his plan? You ever get real frustrated because a day didn't go the way you thought it was going to go? I mean, you get done at the end of the day and you think, man, I didn't get anything done today. I thought I had great plans at the start of the day, and then this happened and that happened and this, and it just seemed like I've been, you know, making about as much progress as a turtle in a jar of peanut butter. I mean, I'm not getting anywhere. Huh? This is nothing. Hey, wait a minute. And you're frustrated. And we say, well, this day didn't go like I planned it to go. Can I help you? It is exactly the way God planned it to go. Your plan or God's plan? You know, when we get frustrated, we're telling God, I had a better plan for my day than you did. Or it's quiet. Frustrated. Instead of saying, this is God's plan for my day. God knows better than I do what I need for the day. Plan? Absolutely. But whatever plans you make, you better make sure, and don't just add it on as an afterthought like sometimes we use in Jesus' name when we pray, when we're not sure if Jesus has put a name to what we just prayed or not. You're looking at me like something's wrong. Nothing's wrong. But listen, if you're going to tell somebody, well, pastor said this, or pastor wants this, you better make sure the pastor said that. And that's what he wants. And if I say, God, this, and by the way, Jesus' name, I'm signing his name to these requests, I better make sure it's what Jesus wants. Your plan or his plan? You in control, or is God in control? Don't just say, well, Lord willing. No, you better really mean that I'm going to make my plans, but God, I'll follow your plan, whatever it is. And you know what? When you have one thing planned and then something completely different happens and you have to, something else comes up, instead of getting frustrated and saying, oh man, now I can't do, you learn to say, okay, God, this must be what you had for me today. All right? It may be an accident on the freeway and you sit there for an hour. Well, Lord, you must want an hour with me today. I'll take it. It beats. What's wrong with this? Get me out of here! No, that's not going to help. Your plan, are you in control or is God in control? Which is it? Which will it be today? Hey, that's the way it is with salvation. Your way or God's way? Well, God's way is to receive Christ as your Savior. Man's way is, I got to do something on my own. I'm going to do something to earn it. But there's a way that seems right unto a man, but the end thereof are the ways of death. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. If you're going to go to heaven, you come through Jesus Christ. That's God's way. Going to be your way? Will it be His way? I trust you'll accept His way. And Christian, accept His control in your life. Don't make plans. You ought to make plans. But make sure you say, if the Lord wills, we'll do this or that. Because God can change your plans. His ways are not our ways. We have to realize He's in control of our life, not us. Let's pray. Father, take the truth now this morning. Thank you for everyone's attention. Lord, I pray that you've ministered to hearts today as only you can do. And I pray, Lord, that decisions have been made in people's hearts. There's something in us, Lord, our flesh, our pride. We like to think we're in control. We like to throw around those words like self-control. And remind us, Lord, that the most important thing is to be under the Spirit's control. And to recognize that you're in control of our lives. And so we ought to say, if the Lord will, we will do this or that. Father, I pray if any in this room have never accepted your way of salvation by placing their faith in Jesus Christ as their Savior, that they would receive Him today. They would realize their way will end in death, separation from God. But if they'll come your way through Jesus Christ, they'll have eternal life. Heads are bowed and eyes are closed. I'll finish the prayer in just a moment. But before I do, I wonder how many in this room would say, Pastor, there's a time when I realized that my way wasn't the right way, but God's way was the right way to heaven. And His way is the only way. It's through Jesus Christ. And there's a time in my life when I asked Christ to be my Savior. And I'm trusting Him alone as my Savior this morning. Pastor, here's my hand as a testimony. Would you slip it up for a moment that I may see it and say, Pastor, that's my testimony? All right, you may put it down. You're here today and would say, Pastor, I don't know for sure. I still think I can do something to get to heaven. Then you and God have a disagreement. I would urge you to understand that God said, the only way is through Jesus Christ. He is the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by Him. If you're here today and you say, Pastor, I've never asked Christ to be my Savior, and I am concerned about that, would you let me pray for you? I'm not going to embarrass you or call you out, but I will remember you in prayer. And I'll pray that you'll settle that in your heart very, very soon. You couldn't raise your hand the first time, but you'd raise it this time. Just say, Pastor, pray for me. I'm not sure that I'd go to heaven when I die. I don't think I've ever received Christ as my Savior. Pray for me. Would you slip your hand up right now and put it back down that I'll see it? Is there anyone like that? You couldn't raise it the first time, but you'll raise it this time. Okay. Now I wonder how many Christians this morning would say, Preacher, the Lord spoke to my heart today. It's got to be God in control, not me in control. It has to be God's plan, not my plan. And Preacher, you may say, Preacher, I've struggled with this. Many of us have. Many of us do. But you'd say, the Spirit of God stopped at my seat today, and He really ministered to my heart. And Pastor, I want God's plan, not my plan. Pastor, pray for me this morning. Would you slip your hand up, Christian? Say, God spoke to my heart. Amen. Amen. God bless you. You may put them down. God's way is the best way. Trust Him for it. Now listen carefully. I'm going to pray in a moment. If you slipped your hand up and God ministered to your heart today, the altar is open for you to come and kneel before Him. If you're here today and you've never received Christ as your Savior, when the pianist begins to play, we stand to our feet. Bob will sing. Slip in your seat. Meet me here at the front. We have people who have been trained. They'll take a Bible and show you how you can know you're on your way to heaven. Be the greatest decision you ever made in your life. If you're here today and you're saved and you've been scripturally baptized and you believe this is where you ought to belong, then you come and say, Preacher, I'd like to belong to the church. I want to serve God here. Whatever it is that the Lord has spoken to your heart about, I just want you to obey Him this morning. Father, have your way now in this invitation. Thank you for speaking to our hearts today. Thank you for decisions that have been made in the hearts of people. Now hear our prayers. We bow the knee at the altar today. And Lord, I pray that we'll bow the knee and say, God, your plan is always the best plan. And I want you to be in control, not me in control. For your way brings victory. And so, Lord, hear our prayer today, and your will be done in every heart and life, please. And I'll thank you for it. With your heads bowed, stand to your feet. As you stand to your feet, our pianist will play. As she plays, Brother Bob's going to sing. God has spoken to your heart today. Respond to Him, please.
You have longed for sweet peace.
That's right.
And for faith to increase, and have earnestly, fervently prayed. But you cannot have rest or be perfectly blessed until all on the altar is laid. Is your all on the altar of sacrifice laid? Your heart does the Spirit control? You can only be blessed and have peace and sweet rest as you yield Him your body and soul. Would you walk with the Lord in the light of His word and have peace and contentment always? You must do His sweet will to be free from all ill. On the altar your all you must lay. Is your all on the altar of sacrifice laid? Your heart does the Spirit control? You can only be blessed and have peace and sweet rest as you yield Him your body and soul. Oh, we never can know what the Lord will bestow of the blessings for which we have prayed, till our body and soul He doth fully control, and our all on the altar is laid. Is your all on the altar of sacrifice laid? Your heart does the Spirit control? You can only be blessed and have peace and sweet rest as you yield Him your body and soul.
Father, we thank you now for this morning. Thank you, Lord, for meeting with us and speaking to our hearts today. It has been good to be in the house of the Lord this morning. Thank you for the people of God that are in this place, and dismiss us now with your care. Make us mindful of your presence with us as we leave this place. And Lord, I pray that you'll watch over us through the afternoon and bring us back safely for the services scheduled for here this evening, Lord. And if you interrupt that and you come back for us, that's okay with us, Lord. Give us a wonderful Lord's Day, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. Brother Bob.
I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by His blood. Joined hands with Jesus as we travel this sod. For I'm a part of the family of God.
Amen. You're dismissed. We'll see you tonight.